What's going on, folks? This is Coleon Noir, and this is another episode of CN Live. And this is a special show for me, essentially, because I remember back when I was deciding to become a lawyer, and I was going through the law school process, of course, taking the LSAT and doing all of that fun stuff that's involved in becoming an attorney and slightly driving you crazy. I remember I read Johnny Cochran's autobiography, and at the time, Johnny Cochran, for me, in that space, was somebody who I looked up to and aspired to be like, and looked to guidance in terms of everything that has to do with being an attorney for all intents and purposes. And there were a bunch of other people in my life, a couple of legal mentors that I've had who had a great effect on me in my legal career. And in many ways, when I started off my firearm journey at the tender age of 25-ish, or something like that, I ventured down the hole. I followed the rabbit all the way down the hole and tried to learn and take in all the things that I possibly could about firearms, the community, the culture, everything. And in doing so, I came across certain people who I ended up looking up to from a firearm standpoint, people who I aspired to be like, who set a standard that I wanted to achieve and accomplish. And lucky for me, joining me today is one of those people. And he goes by the name of Travis Haley. What's going on, Trav?
What's up, Noir? How you been, man?
Doing pretty good. I feel like I'm seeing a lot more of you lately after taking that 3-day course. I'm starting to get sick of you a little bit. But, I don't even want to pull any punches. I just kind of want to jump right into it. I know you and I, we've had several conversations before that have not been recorded. And I always walk away really enlightened and learning a lot of stuff and just kind of going back and forth. And I know our journeys in this industry are a little bit different. You know, you more so on the training side and more badassery side of things. Me more on the running my mouth and breathing through it side. But nonetheless, you know, we definitely tend to think on the same wavelength in many ways, especially when it comes to the industry. And as far as the gun community as a whole, you've been in it a lot longer than I have. Where do you see the state of the current gun community as it stands right now?
Ooh.
Yeah, I love giving these broad questions, right?
Yeah, it's a loaded question. I know, it's awesome. First, thanks for having me on the show, guys.
Absolutely.
Where's it going, right? Well, I think from a shooting community standpoint, because then there's the industry attached to that, you know, like we always talk about. I think it's obviously got a lot of potential as long as everybody understands what they're getting themselves into. And that's where we try to come in with, you know, the education, you know, the experience, right? The story of trying to share with people and empower them and even inspire them if we need to come out and be a part of it, you know? And I think the more we can continue to do that as an industry on our end, with communication and giving those people that experience, I think it's going to continue to grow. So, but there's always the other side of it as well. You know, there's always infighting in every industry and community, and there's the little cults or the rifts.
Little clicks that you
see start. And it's like you mentioned earlier, you know, you said, well, like we come at the industry or the community from two different ways, right? But what is our core? Why do you do what you do, and why do I do what I do?
It's because, I know for me, it started off as something that was just supposed to be a hobby, you know, but that wasn't the foundation. That was kind of the surface level aspect of everything, right? Inherently, as I started to do that and kind of follow that road, it started to become more and more about the concepts under the Constitution, the ideas of the Second Amendment, and what that represents to not only my life, but everybody in this country. So, and that started to serve as that foundation, that base, and that core. And I noticed that, and one thing that I really loved and I fed off of, the energy I fed off of, is that was something that was consistent throughout all aspects of the community, whether it be the training side, the competition side, all of it. At its core, there was one individual aspect of it that everyone stood firm on, and I love that component.
Right, and that's because we care.
Yeah,
I think that's the biggest thing that drives everything that we do, and that's what I want everybody to get out of it is, you know, why do you carry a gun for a living? You know, as a law enforcement officer or as a responsible armed citizen, why do you have a gun in your house? It's not to kill somebody because of their evil motive, or if you had to do that, which, you know, of course, worst case scenario, hopefully never happens to anyone. Mm-hmm. But if you did, why did you do it? Was it because of that evil intent, or was it because you care about something more precious?
Yeah.
And I think that is, like I always say, it's the number one attribute to any warrior, whether you're over in Durkistan somewhere and fighting evil, you know, terrorist, or whether you're in your own home in the middle of the night protecting your kids as a mom or a dad. You become a warrior really quick.
Yeah.
And it's because of the compassion you have. And that's what I want people to understand, is if you're going to carry a gun in society to uphold a higher standard of care, you don't do it because you get to carry a gun.
Yeah. You
know? And hopefully that compassion will lead you to better decision making, better thinking, not just shooting, as we like to say.
And you know, it was and of course I'd be amiss if I didn't bring up the Magpul days, in which, because I mean that's kind of where my journey started, sure. with those videos and training courses and things of that nature. It took me from being just a spectator in the community to wanting to actually get out there and do stuff. Like I'm kind of mad at you for that a little bit. Because I was really content with just, you know, I'm just going to go to the range, shoot a couple of rounds, and then I'm just going to amass a bunch of guns, look at them, and call them pretty, and call it a day. But no, I come across these DVDs, and then all of a sudden there's this bug in me that just wants to go out there and just do something with my firearm that allow me to improve as not only just a person in a gun, but as a person as a whole. And I was no longer satisfied with just kind of being a spectator in the community. And so I blame you for that in many ways. So thank you, Travis.
Yeah. Look at you now. You know, and that was in those days, that was actually an experiment to see, you know, with social media coming online and all the different platforms that we were starting to have, you know, when we came into that time, because I'd been training with my own company before that. And we said, hey, look, here's the training world the way it is right now. Here's the market space. Here's people. And so how do we create an experience? Because, I mean, I know we talked about numbers. I mean, how many people, there's over 300 million guns,
yeah,
you know,
and like 5, yeah,
like 11 million concealed carry permit holders. There's 5 million plus people in the NRA.
Yeah.
Like, we can only really physically get out there and communicate and touch and feel and help people in a class environment, maybe 1,000 people a year with my organization, plus. So we said, well, hey, how do we reach the rest of them that really want to have a part of this? So the guys that can't come out to a class, they don't have the money or time off of work, they can't get away from family, but they need some type of reference material where they can at least study and become better in their own time. And then when they do come to a course, it's kind of a primer for them,
yeah,
or a refresher after they go to a course. So that was the experiment to, you know, number one, educate, number two, motivate, number three, slightly entertain, which, you know, that was a balance because we didn't understand that world at the time. But mostly empower and inspire people to say, hey, look, you can come out here and do this too. And that's why we gave that student perspective, so people could relate to other people and say, look, yeah, that could be me. I can do this. And so then that's what I think boomed and became revolutionary in the media side of our industry, was giving people a story and experience to relate to and creating that, you know, that emotional bond to say, hey, I can do this, man. I can be that too and have fun.
Yeah. And I mean, even if I couldn't be it on the level that you guys were, I knew that I could try and attempt and then become a better version of myself.
Absolutely.
You know? And also one of the things that did very well too was, at the time, YouTube hadn't really been as developed as it is now. So it provided a one-stop shop for a lot of information that I was seeking. A lot of information that now I take for granted, you know, because there are a lot of new people who are coming on board now who don't necessarily know the things that I know, but in my mind now they're just second nature. You know, and it's, I always have to kind of remind myself about that, because there's a lot of stuff that I kind of just gloss over in my head. I'm like, shouldn't you know that already? But, you know, I mean, I've been doing this for a couple of years now, you know.
Yeah, shooting's very complex. There's nothing simple about it as much as people try to make it simple. And I think that's where we get lost in translation with, you know, the whole word tactical and dynamics and everything that we do. Those are actually words that mean something. And I think that's something else I would want to share with people out there is, you know, don't forget what that means. Don't forget that tactics is your mental decision-making process in a combative situation that determines your success or failure, not the gear you're wearing or how cool your gun looks.
Yeah.
And I know there's been that wave, and I kind of feel partly responsible for it with the media side, but at the same time, I'm also responsible and take on an even greater responsibility to share and educate people and adapt and move, you know, through the correct paces.
We got to take a quick break, but when we come back, I kind of want to touch on the gear component a little bit as far as that applies to the industry. So just don't forget that thought, and we'll be back.